bright, cold day in April.
1984. It's here.
It's not far off.
Did you have to read that book in school?
Yeah. No? I'm think that was mandatory for everybody to read, and it's one of those, like, that'll never happen. Okay, this is an interesting book, but okay. Now it's like, fuck.
Right, it's like actually happening every second of every day.
I'm just waiting for the fictional war. If it wasn't for the fact that I was at one of them, I would have wondered. But, like, yeah, that's next.
Which is happening faster? 1984 becoming truth.
Yeah.
Or the Jetsons.
Yeah, 1984.
Yeah, because we still don't have flying cars.
Not even close.
And my dog can't push a button to get fed.
No, we're still at backup cameras. Yeah. About as close to that as we've got. Flying cars, not in the near future. We can't even use turn signals, let alone flying cars.
Guess we ought to introduce ourselves. Welcome, shitheads, to episode 32 of the Shots Fired podcast. We seem to be doing about two of these a week lately.
Yeah.
Somebody asked me, they're like, do you do this on a regular schedule? I'm like, no, it usually only after shit happens. When shit hits the fan, we report about that shit.
Which is about every other day now.
Yeah, it seems to be like literally today we've got five or six different topics to talk about.
Yeah.
And we're going to try to get through it quickly because we know it's Friday. You got shit to do.
Bearded
and
drink.
Fat Dark Earth doesn't want to spend all night editing this thing. So let's see if we can jump right into it. What's our first topic, Alex?
I've got the one that I think would probably be most relevant to a lot of our fans. The individual in Texas getting charged, the first individual to get charged with a bump stock.
That did break today, didn't it? About 16 hours ago.
Yeah.
The first guy ever to be charged with possession of a bump stock. Everybody always said, oh, they won't use those charges unless you use it in a crime.
No crime was committed.
Crazy? Crime of stupidity?
Yeah. I mean, this isn't an upstanding law-abiding citizen with no previous background.
What's a law-abiding citizen?
Law-abiding.
There you go.
Citizen.
You're spitting on me.
with a perfectly stable mental health.
No. This guy was a couple apples short of an orchard.
I mean, he made Dixon look good.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Perfectly sane.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this guy was not red flagged. He red flagged himself, much like the last podcast we were talking about the Texas shooter, how he red flagged himself.
Yeah.
It didn't work. This guy, he's a 42-year-old male, and he had sent an email to the George W. Bush something or other. I don't know if
The George W. Bush Foundation.
Yes. And he said, please send your guys to come and kill me.
Yeah, and that he wanted to die by the hands of a white Christian.
Correct.
By the name, not being racist, just stating the obvious, his name sounds Indian. I can't even pronounce it.
It's definitely of a
not
different
American
origin.
Right. Yeah.
And so he wants to die at the hands of a white Christian. And so you send an email like this to the former president of the United States, and you get one of these.
Yeah.
And they came in, and they found a bump stock on a rifle. Right?
400 rounds. I've heard 400 rounds of ammo, and then I've heard four 100-round magazines loaded.
Yeah, I heard 100 rounds in the story that I read.
Yeah, there's been a few conflicting reports on that, but the guy had, I mean, 400 rounds is not an alarming amount of ammo by any means.
So this guy, he had been adjudicated a mentally defective.
Yeah.
And that's the big crime here, is that he shouldn't have had a gun in the first place, period. He's making not necessarily threats of violence. It's more requests of violence.
Yeah, suicidal, like homicidal type.
Yeah. So he shows suicidal tendencies by asking the president's men to come and kill him. And then he's in possession of a firearm with a bump stock attached to it. And so he's caught a bunch of charges.
Probably fucked on this one.
Yeah,
I don't
feel sorry for him. Do you think this is like the beginning? Do you think that they're now going to start going after the super crazies? Because I got friends in the Secret Service.
Yeah.
Right? And the stories I've heard for the last 10 or 15 years from these guys, it's just amazing how many total fucking nut jobs are out there.
There's no shortage.
That are like, hey, look at me, I'm nuts.
Yeah.
I have guns and stuff.
Yeah.
I'm crazy and I want to kill people or have them kill me. And are they going to start going, at all their houses now? I don't know if that's a bad thing, is it?
Yeah,
I mean,
yes,
when you in this case,
no.
In this case, is it a bad thing?
No.
No.
But we're talking the government, so it starts.
It's always
there.
A bad thing.
Yeah. Where does it stop? And my only issue is this sets the precedence for court cases. So when they refer to previous court cases in the future, this will be one of the foundational ones. And if this goes through all clear, because everybody's like, okay, this guy was fucking crazy, probably shouldn't have had that, and they establish that, that's now set in stone. I'm not a lawyer, but that's like just basic knowledge on that shit, that any time there's especially constitutional court cases, they refer back to previous conclusions from
I don't think there's anything wrong with this. I can't get my panties in a wad over this.
No.
Because you have crazy guy sends suicidal emails, violent emails with suicidal context to a president.
Yeah.
And they come knock on the door. And it does not say whether they forced their way in or he just let them in. So we don't know the context of the search and seizure. Right?
No. In a previous article I read, because I know you sent me one, there's a few out there. One of them stated that he was not only forcibly committed to a mental institution, but was diagnosed also as a schizophrenic. So, I mean, he is obviously not mentally stable.
Schizophrenic people are fucking dangerous.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
So that is the big news of the day, but it's not the only news of the day.
No.
So the shooting that spurred this podcast, because that's what we do, right? We talk about Monday morning quarterback shootings, especially ones that get national attention.
Yeah.
Especially if they're law enforcement involved.
And or involve the Second Amendment.
Second Amendment, ISIS, whatever. The shootings that matter.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'd be doing shootings every 5 seconds about Chicago.
Yes.
Or shots fired podcast every 5 seconds about Chicago. Those shootings don't matter.
No.
I'm just kidding. They do matter, but nobody seems to care. So, moving on. The San Bernardino deputy. You guys heard about this one? I think we got a video of this. Can we, Fat Dark Earth, can we play that video really quick? This is my favorite part. He tries to, the gun goes off, and then she jumps up to run away. He takes a shot at her, and then here comes the cavalry.
What?
Three police cars at the same time.
And he's fucked.
Yeah. Hands up, don't. Oh, yep, they shot him.
We'll get that with a bigger job.
What I loved about that, okay, there's so much to talk about here, but the best part, me being an ex-cop, is that the guy, he's got his hands up with the gun, and he walks, takes like 3 steps forward, and a tree branch completely eliminates any kind of argument. Because now it becomes their body cams against whatever. I mean, I forget these new cops have body cams. But nonetheless, the video that we've got, you can't see him lower the gun. He's got his hands up walking towards the cops. And they just unleash on him.
Grant, if you're going to surrender and turn yourself in, you got the put your hands up part right.
Yeah.
You
probably ought to drop the gun
down.
Like and it was probably a Glock, so it wasn't like he was worried that it was going to shoot him in the ass if he threw it on the ground.
Exactly. It's not a 320 here.
Right. No SIGs in this one.
Bringing
right?
that back.
But, hey, what kind of gun does Santa Bernardino deputies carry? Does
Somebody's
anybody know? Comment that in the comments on the podcast. So,
do they carry California-compliant pistols?
Actually, I think they do get to carry high-capacity magazines, but only on duty. They have to, like, put their high capacities in a locker and get their 10-rounders out when they drive home or some shit. But anyway, we're getting off track.
Yeah.
Right? So there's lots to this story. It's not just female officer beaten up by 21-year-old black male, and then he takes a shot at her, and then the arriving cavalry smoke checks him. Okay. Let's start with her. All right. She is actually one of those internet hotties, one of those thought cops, right? She's the thought police. Did I just coin a new phrase?
No, that's another 1984 quote, I thought.
The thought police. And so actually, her real name, Megan Forsberg, and I'm joking right now, she's actually a really good person. She's done ambassador work for Grunstyle. She's done all kinds of charity work. We've posted her pictures. She is a smoke show. The chick is hot as shit. Hopefully we're showing a picture of her right now. But you can't find her Instagram because she had shitloads of fans.
Yeah.
You know, she was a influencer.
Yes.
What we're going to call the thought police from now on. But her department made her, this is what I was told, they made her take down her Instagram during the investigation.
Because that's probably not a bad
decision. Yeah, the department didn't want that blowing up and you know, all those pictures of her big, round, supple breasts in the multicam bikini tops and fully tacked out.
What were we talking about?
After she gets the gun taken away from her, so he's beating her in the face and head, right? This guy's kicking her ass.
Yeah, it didn't go well.
Which brings up questions as to her hand-to-hand training, you know?
It's training period. It's going to, every time there's one of these shots fired involving law enforcement where there's tons of rounds exchanged, no one hit, anytime the guns wrestle, it comes down to training every time. These guys don't get enough, and ladies, don't get enough fucking training.
It seems like a lot of cops are going towards Brazilian jiu-jitsu. You know, when I was a cop, we were learned. I'm showing my Midwest redneck. We were taught.
We were learned.
PPCT, which was pressure point control tactics, which was a simplified version of Hokkaido.
Yeah.
We were also taught PR24 baton, straight stick baton, and you know, we didn't have tasers and stuff, so if the mace didn't work, we'd beat you with a stick.
Most of you guys were just taught drunken Irish style of fighting.
Right. Stomp the fuck out of somebody. But we were also, you know, the fact is, she didn't create distance. She got into a grappling situation. He got close, started punching her in the face and head. They go to the ground. She goes for her firearm.
In my opinion, that's not a wise decision. If you're getting overpowered, going for your firearm would probably be the least wise decision.
She was obviously scared for her life. No, she was getting ready to deploy lethal force, but she wasn't able to deploy the lethal force because then the bad guy stopped beating her in the head and got both hands on her strong arm.
I believe and several shots are fired.
One shot is fired. We're not sure if she fired the first shot or if he fired the first shot.
Yeah.
The second shot went into the dirt a few inches from her fucking head.
You can see the little puff of dirt.
Goes right past her head, and she, at that point, I guess, let's go with a gun, gets up and takes off running, screaming, "No, no, 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 don't shoot me."
Yeah.
And he, as if he'd been trained, racks around to make sure he's ready to go, and bang, he lets one fly in her direction.
The one thing I'll say is, it just caught me as weird, and maybe I'm reading too much into it. It was the way he did that was awfully, like, dramatized. It was real dramatic the way he did it.
Yeah, it was. It was almost like he watched Colors too many times, or maybe Boys in the Hood.
Yeah,
you know,
it was just fucking weird. The whole, like, come down like that. Yeah. It was just weird.
Yeah, and who knows if he actually meant to shoot her or if he just shot near her or whatever. We're not going to debate his marksmanship. But nonetheless, then the cavalry comes around the corner, three cars deep all together, which I thought was a little suspect. These guys were all down the street at the shop hanging out together or something. They all ended up coming around the corner at the same exact time, undoubtedly responding to an officer in need of aid call. She must have gotten a call out or hit her button on, you know, she has a tone button on her radio. Now, these officers probably, they did not see him fire the shot. She might have been yelling on her radio, "Don't shoot me, don't shoot me." We don't know. Well, that'll come out later. But somehow, these guys were so amped up when they got out of the cars that they yelled, "Drop the gun, ba 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 ba." And they fired somewhere between 7 and 12 shots at this guy.
Now that's a lot of damage!
And it wasn't until the 8th shot that he was struck. The first 7 shots completely missed him. The 8th one hit him, and then the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th also missed him.
And I mean, just quarterbacking it, if you watch from the video, it's not like it was a far distance.
No, they were 15 yards max. I mean, he was walking towards them.
Yeah, that should have been a real. And, I mean, you.
With his white tee. I mean, yeah, these guys were all in the A pillar V, and they were all firing stable.
Yeah.
Right? And this goes to show that either A, marksmanship training in law enforcement. And you wouldn't think it'd be like that in San Bernardino. They get in shootings all the time.
Yeah, there is a lot out there.
But either their marksmanship sucked, or this is an example of adrenaline dump. You know, they're on their way to an officer in need of aid. She's not just any officer. She's the female officer, the thought police that everybody wants to everybody wants to bed. And so she's maybe the department kitten, and they're, oh, my God, she's getting beat up.
Yeah.
And so they got this adrenaline dump when they get there, and, you know, they become a shit show of shooting.
So similar story. On my first deployment, we one of the sister mobile assault platoons rolled out to do a routine patrol, and our company commander went out with him. He did that occasionally, just, I don't know why, to pretend like he did something too. So he rolled out with them, and they decided to do a random snatch VCP, which is where you literally just out of nowhere pick a spot on the road, set up some quick, hasty barricades with Constantino wire, stop the next vehicle that rolls up and search it. Turns out the next vehicle that rolled up, they searched, had weapons and IED-making material on them. Fucking shocker. And as they approached the vehicle, the guy stepped behind the door and engaged with an AK-47 from somewhere between 15 and 30 yards away. And the CO, very excited, raised his rifle and unloaded on this guy and missed every fucking shot. And,
all 30?
Yeah.
Mag dump.
Yeah.
Didn't hit
from,
shit.
From with an M4 from a pretty decent proximity. And it wasn't until, and I'll leave out his name, one of our, who ended up becoming my vehicle commander, raised his rifle, took a few quick shots, and all rounds impacted on target and dropped him. Proper rapid decompression of the chest chamber. And from there ensued... Yeah, I'm just going to stop there. The rest of it...
Yeah, we should probably redact the rest.
The rest of it we'll just not get into. Other things were taken care of and dealt
with. War stories with Dynadeath Milberg.
But, I mean, same thing. Shots that shouldn't have been missed. And it is an officer. It is a captain. There is always a chance that rifle was never zeroed. Rifle was never sighted in. Scope was taken off for cleaning, put back on, and never... There's a list of things that could have happened. But all in all, there should be no reason from that type of distance you'd miss with that many rounds.
Right. It's just, it's lack of training. It's lack of control.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things they taught us, you know, when you're running code to a call, the longer you run code, the faster you're going, the more your adrenaline's up. Mm-hmm. And they taught us breathing techniques when we're getting closer to the call, you know, to check the adrenaline.
Yeah.
Right? And to really try to control it so that we didn't get out of the car at the end of the pursuit and beat someone to death or miss the shots we need to take or shoot the wrong person or whatever, just because you've got tunnel vision, audio occlusion, you know, all the bad things that happen with the adrenaline dump. So, but anyway, she was injured in the fight. She got struck several times. Fortunately, she didn't get shot.
Yeah. All minor injuries.
And, we wish her the best. We hope that she comes back. She'll probably never talk to us after she hears the thought police thing, but come on, it's funny. It's funny.
It's all in good humor.
Yeah, it's all in good humor. We love you. We hope you're better and you come back and join your police force and, get some better hand-to-hand fighting training. We just had another shooting in St. Louis.
I don't have local TV. I didn't even hear this one.
Nobody's heard of this one, although there has been some protests. But it hasn't gone too viral yet. Last weekend, I think it was Friday, before Labor Day weekend.
Yeah.
There was a 23-year-old black male at the Galleria Mall. I used to actually work police security at the Galleria during the holidays. It was a great gig. I made tons of money. And
not the first Ellie to say that, too. I've heard a lot of guys that was like the gig because, A, it was entertaining.
It was the Valley of Poon. It was always full of action. And you got to know the girls at all the stores, so they gave you discounts. You got employee discounts on everything.
Nice.
So I'd make like $40 or $50 an hour to be armed police security.
God damn.
Basically, we were a team. And our job at the Galleria, our job back then, I don't think I'm under any kind of contract or anything these days, but our job back then was to squash anything that happened and to keep it from being reported to the local police department. Like, just fucking squash it, get them the
handle
fuck. We actually had a tunnel under the mall, and you would take them out through the... snatch him, pull him into the hallway, take him down to the bottom, and have a Richmond Heights car pull in, stick him in a car, and all the happy people shopping had no idea.
For people listening who aren't locals, the Galleria, too, this is like your high-end, falutin fucking...
It used to be super high-end.
Yeah.
It's gone downhill quite a bit.
Yeah, but it used to be one of the fucking and, Gucci stores.
Yeah, I mean,
shit.
And so, you know, our modus operandi was as soon as somebody walked in that fit the profile, you know, the cameras were on them.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, we were on them. But we worked carjackings, rapes, shootings, all kinds of shit during the holidays at this mall. And most people just never heard about it. Cops are working security. There's security guards at the mall Friday, and they see a 23-year-old black male. His name was Tillman. I say was because he's now dirt-napped. He was walking into the mall with a Glock in his waistband and had an extendo mag. He had a 31 round ETS mag hanging out of his pants, you know, and with it stuck in probably the appendix. And somebody saw this, and security and law enforcement approached him. Now, here's the thing. I'm going to get super controversial with this one because it's open carry state, right?
Yeah. No, it
you
is.
Can conceive it's a Missouri's a constitutional carry state.
Yeah.
It's an open carry state. So at this point, Mr. Tillman, and I want to talk to Kevin Dixie about this, see what his opinion is of this. But this young black man had done nothing wrong.
No, I mean, what he was doing was perfectly smart. No, I mean,
yeah,
it is what it is.
This is why we preach concealed carry. Just because open carry is a thing doesn't mean you should do it. It's stupid.
Yeah,
because you have things like this happen. Now, this story does twist and turn,
of course.
But he walks into the mall. He's got the extendo hanging out. Security immediately approaches him, and they do a field interview and ask him to leave the property because the property is posted no firearms. Right. So in Missouri, if you come into a place and you have a firearm and it's posted no firearms, if it's concealed, they don't know. If they see it because you bent over and it fell out of your waistband, or you know, you showed it when you bent over and you know the holster or the you know the holster shows or something, they can ask you to leave and that's it, right? If you come back a second time, it's now felony trespassing.
Same with if you refuse
misdemeanor trespassing.
Yeah, you can even refuse to leave, and the most that happens
is trespassing. Right, and so at this point. Something happens. They want him, you know, they're approaching him because it's not illegal, but it's against the mall rules to have a gun, which therefore they need to advise him of the trespassing rule and ask him to leave. At which time, though, I'm sure the officers involved, now I'm speculating, probably wanted to do a field interview report, what we used to call a FIR, which is essentially your name, date of birth, social security number. I'm going to see if you got any warrants on you, bro.
Yeah.
Right. And at this point, some people say he walked away. Some people said he runned away. he done run away, and they pursued him.
Yeah.
They being a 50-year-old Richmond Heights police officer, I believe. And so they pursued him into a parking garage off property. In the Clayton area.
Which there's a bunch in that area. There's
right.
A parking garage every 20 fucking
So
feet.
This is probably a block or two away.
Yeah.
You know, away from the property that they pursued him, at which time the officer claims that he turned, drew the weapon, raised the weapon, and the officer shot him 5 times in the abdomen. Nice tight grouping. He's no longer breathing. Then they found out that he was a felon.
Yeah.
And was not legally allowed to possess a firearm, much less carry one into the Galleria Mall.
Yeah.
The so it's a story that ends well for law enforcement. But what if he wasn't a felon? Did they know he was a felon before they pursued him? Did they get the info and that's why he ran? I don't know. I don't know the details, but all I know is they put this guy down, and here's what kind of disturbed me on the news the other night. Now I'm not a bootlicker, but I'm pretty pro law enforcement. Mm-hmm. You know, and this is a quote from the spokesperson for the St. Louis County Police Department. Any reason? It's 2019. Any reasonable person who sees an extended magazine protruding from a person, especially in law enforcement capacity, has an obligation to contact the individual and investigate. That was Sergeant Ben Granda with the St. Louis County Police. He then says, look nationally. See if we have any mass shootings. There is no way you cannot address that person. Those signs are posted on every door going into that establishment. Mr. Tillman was contacted by those officers, and I wish they would have explained the policy, and he would have come back to do his shopping on another date when he was not armed. So, you know, basically, this spokesperson for the St. Louis County Police is saying, hey, it might be legal for you to carry a gun, but you bet your ass if we see your gun, we're going to interview you.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that's fucking cool. I mean, you don't have the right to fucking interview me. Now, if I'm walking into the Galleria, yes. But if I'm not on private property with posted no guns and you see me carrying a gun, you see my extendo sticking out of my pants.
Fuck off.
Yeah, fuck off.
And, I mean, I'm without going too much into a rant. Yeah, no, I mean, the fact of it, he didn't say that exact circumstance, but period. That it's law enforcement's job, because of what's happening today.
Because of all the mass shootings, that if they see a magazine, an extended magazine specifically is what he said, that it's their duty to investigate.
Now, I have a few points I'd like to bring up.
Okay.
First one, nothing against cops. There's a lot who know lots about firearms, vast firearms knowledge. There are also some who can barely tell you what fucking model firearm they carry on duty every day and don't ever shoot past going to qualification. I'm going to let that fucking guy determine what an extended magazine is, and anywhere, stop and interview me. I'm sorry, but to quote South Park, I thought this was America.
Right.
If I am well within my constitutional and legal rights to be able to carry a firearm of any fucking capacity, doesn't say you can carry except this capacity. No, Missouri doesn't have a capacity law. I'm well within my rights and legalities to carry that. And to be stopped and interviewed, you know, what if I'm at, you know, a grocery store or something, reaching for the top shelf, my shirt goes up, and you barely see enough to know that I have something?
Well, if the grocery store is posted no firearms and they see that, they have the ability to ask you to leave.
Or anywhere where there's not even a sign posted. Yeah.
But do they have the right then to run your name and social security number?
I mean, it'd be interesting.
That's a gray area.
I wonder what it would take for us to have a day where we do shots fired with a fucking lawyer.
Yeah.
And
have
find
a lawyer,
out.
A cop, and a black guy all walk into the bar.
We can make that happen. But, I mean, what's the legalities of if you're questioned and you know you're being questioned for something that you are completely lawfully doing and in legal boundaries of being 100% okay, do you have to answer the question? Do you have to give your name and information? Do you have to give your driver's license?
Keep going with that thought. I'm going to look something up here because I have an answer to your question. It's just going to take me a second to find it.
I've personally wondered that because, I mean, I'm not going to give any more information than I'm legally bound to. It's nobody's business but mine. And as long as I'm abiding by the law and not breaking any laws and allowed to possess that firearm, then whatever I have on me is my fucking business and mine alone.
If we can have a lawyer on the show, this is the one I want right here.
Mark and Craig, Pop Brothers at Law. We've been warning people, if you are working for an unlicensed dispensary, an illegal dispensary,
this is not the right
raided,
one.
You
stand by. Let's start
I
over.
I know who those two
Let's
guys
start over.
Are.
Let's start over.
Shut the fuck up.
If we can have an attorney on this show, this is the one I want right here.
Mark and Craig, Pop Brothers at Law. We've been warning people, if you are working for an unlicensed dispensary, an illegal dispensary, and it gets raided, you need to shut the fuck up. If you shut the fuck up, you have a good chance that we can make the case go away. Case in point, three employees of an illegal shop were can't prove what you were doing there if you're a customer, patient. Questions?
Not discussing my day.
And they ask more questions?
Am I being detained or am I free to go?
And if detained, what do you say?
I invoke the Fifth.
And then what do?
You shut the fuck up.
I saw that I would hire those guys.
That
just
right there is exactly what you do. It doesn't matter that you're working at an illegal dispensary. You know, if you're detained by the police, you
shut the fuck up.
Am I being detained? Invoke the Fifth. Shut the fuck up. Get your attorney.
Yeah.
Now, anyway, we got off track. I want to get that guy on the show. That'd be fucking awesome. We could have a lot of fun with that. But anyway, so this is a big deal in St. Louis. There was two people arrested at protesting at the Galleria the other night, and they say if the officer's not indicted, they're going to burn the Galleria to the ground, which wouldn't be a huge loss. But
no,
I'm not in any way saying go burn the Galleria down. That's a bad idea. That's a felony. Do not commit arson. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying anything. All right,
shut
the fuck up. I invoke the Fifth. And let's move on to the next story. Before we move on to the next story, though, let's thank our sponsors. Right?
I think one of them is a dead giveaway.
One of them is a dead giveaway. It is Adam's Arms, and they pay us with guns.
I love it.
We work for guns because we are not above shilling for free shit.
Especially when we're shilling for someone we believe in and love.
Absolutely, because they have a patented piston system that runs cleaner, puts all the gases out the front of the gun, and is the best fucking solution for anything suppressed. Never clean your gun again. Use an Adams piston kit to build your next rifle, or buy an Adams P1, P2, or P3 rifle. But you don't have to do that either, because we're going to give you one.
What? But tell me more.
Oh, I will. So what we have on the table here, this little guy.
This one's mine.
I like to call him Thumper, okay? This is a pistol. See? I'm just like Charlie's Angels, right? This is a pistol. Oh, yeah. Check it out.
Not 5.56, ladies and gentlemen.
No. This is a pistol. A 308 pistol. And I'm not a super strong man, but this is a very light 308 pistol. Man, is it beautiful. It's got the EOTech on it. It's got the Lancer magazine. It's got the nice Magpul grip with the SBA-3. It's got the Adams Arms rail system, A2 birdcage, and it's just beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. This is one of the prizes we're giving away in the Adams Arms Boogaloo Bugout Kit.
Now, wait, are you telling me that fine XPS 2, if I'm looking at it correctly, EOTech
Correct.
Is included?
Yes, the EOTech is included. That's actually from Adams Arms. They threw that in. But that's not all. Wait, there's more. We're also going to, we partnered with another sponsor, Witt Machine. Witt Machine makes the Dirty 30 suppressor, the little short fat suppressor. Right? That handles 30 cal, hearing safe, and they're going to put one of those on here, and they're going to pay your tax stamp.
Oh, ho, ho, ho.
Suppressor plus tax stamp on this, but that's not all. Hornady kicked in five cases of 308 155 FTX, critical defense 308. This is not your mama's 308.
That's that Gucci ammo.
It's Gucci 308. Hornady's throwing in five cases, which equals 1,000 rounds. You're going to be able to put those five cases, if you've been working out, in your TruSpec 3-day rucksack while you're wearing your TruSpec combat fleece shirt and your TruSpec expedition multicam pants.
Oh.
And Enforce is going to put a light and laser on the end of this. And they're going to give you an Enforce flashlight for your EDC as well.
Dear God.
Vet TV is kicked in on this. They're giving away an iPad with the Vet TV app, which if you don't have the Vet TV app, yeah. Go ahead and just fuck right off now.
You're missing out in life.
Oh, my God. The titties are worth the fucking $10 a year or whatever you pay for it.
Yeah.
So you got the Vet TV iPad app and a year subscription to Vet TV. So when the Boogaloo kicks off, you're going to be fashionable as fuck in your TruSpec gear with your 3-day rucksack, your 308 pistol with all of the trimmings, lights, lasers from Enforce, your EDC light from Enforce, your iPad so that when you're not boogalooing, you can be watching Vet TV
Kick
reruns.
Back, get some laughs.
You can be checking out me in the first season of Checkpoint Charlie. How about that?
That's right.
Am I forgetting anybody? Witt Machine with the suppressor and the tax stamp. Man, if I am, I'm a fucktard, but I think I've nailed it all. And you can sign up to win this. I think you can get like 8 or 10 chances to win this just by clicking on the link in the podcast.
Do I get 8 or 10 chances?
Unfortunately, because you work here, I don't think you're eligible to win. But that beautiful 6.5 Creedmoor Adams Arms P3 rifle with a carbon fiber barrel. That one, the one that came in, that because you're on the shooting team as a precision marksman and you're doing all the precision gun stuff. That's your do you really need to win this thing?
No. I already have a 12.5 308.
And they decided to send me a new 3-gun rifle, which I haven't even done the review video on yet. This just came in.
Yes.
This is the Adams Arms Core. Essentially, they don't call it the Core anymore. A lot of you guys that have been around for a long time know that I have a Core, that I was shooting a Core back when the Core was invented.
This is a bit of a step up.
This is the new and improved Core. It's got the CMC trigger, 45-degree selector switch. It's the Adams P3, which means it also has the carbon fiber barrel.
223 Wild Proof Research.
It's got the lightened rail system. It's got the mag pull. What are these? These are the badass mag pull sights. What are these called?
Oh, actually, I believe those are Core sights. I'm not super familiar with them. I've heard of them. Those might be the pros. I know on the 12.5, it's a.
I thought these were mag pulls, but they're not. They are Defiance.
That's right, Defiance Machining.
Yeah, Defiance Machining. Yeah, M-lock rail system, carbon fiber, super lightweight. So we're up to our elbows in Adams Arms, but you get to win this one with a suppressor and all the fun shit just by clicking on the link and supporting the sponsors at the bottom or top of the podcast, wherever you're watching this or listening to it. Now that we got done doing that, we've got one more sponsor to talk about, and that is Clip Draw.
I didn't know where that
this one is not connected to my nutsack. But you notice we've got the Kydex trigger sheath, which immediately breaks free.
Wow.
Got the clip draw clip.
Magazine.
This is a magazine. This is a clip.
I can't stop.
It's the only time you can put a clip on your gun and be technically correct. But anyway, clip draw is offering a special to tactical shitheads that listen to this podcast. If you're looking for a super affordable, low-vis holster solution like this so that you can go gangsta, like I'm doing right now, you buy the clip draw and you use the promo code tactical shit or shithead, whichever one you remember, and then you include the Kydex trigger sheath because that's a must.
Yeah.
And then what their website does is it gives you a BOGO. You get another $5 off for buying two things. So you use our promo code to get 20% off and free shipping. Then you buy both things, getting a BOGO. And so you end up getting like $60 worth of shit for $33 or something like that.
It's a pretty good deal.
It's a really good deal. Go to clipdraw.com. Tell them Tactical Shit sent you, please. All right. Back to the podcast. We got a few more things to talk about.
Yeah.
Which one you want to hit on next?
Man, this one personally is concerning me. Talking about, you know, we did the intro with 1984. This is some 1984 shit. The subpoena to try to get Google and Apple to give up names and information, IPNs, for 10,000 plus members who signed up for the Obsidian 4 app. It's a app that runs with ATN's optics. They're real well known for their night vision, specifically thermal optics at a budget price.
Yep. The kind of night vision optics you use to hunt hogs or coyote or fox or groundhogs.
It's an app that works
ISIS.
Yes. It's an app that works with that. And so reading further into it and their reasoning, and here's what really concerns me. Because the government, they're not going to be outright with it. They're sneaky, you know, kind of like a Pearl Harbor. That was a real sneaky. They try to be sneaky with it, and they are claiming it is for ITAR reasons.
Right.
And that they're doing it to see how many of these have violated ITAR.
It's actually ICE.
Yeah, ICE is using it. And seeing how many of these were imported or arms trafficking to areas that shouldn't have this. And their guys under that is use the IPNs and see where they're at and who's been using it. But in order to find out who's using it and where it's not supposed to be, they need everyone's information who signed up for it.
Right. Basically, what they want, just to recap that and to put it, to frame it up. So these are night vision or thermal optics,
okay, which are definitely covered under ITAR, which means they cannot be exported by anybody that doesn't have an ITAR license. And an ITAR license costs a shitload of money every single day to be able to export weapons, and then you better be exporting them to the right people.
It's not even fucking worth it.
The fact that ICE is involved in this kind of tells us that they think these thermal optics are going south of the border. And so in order to identify the locations of where these thermal optics are, the government is subpoenaing Google and Apple, saying we want the app info on these things, because they're making an assumption that if the app is opened in Sinaloa or Sinaloa, whatever, if an app is open there, that somebody there must have the ATN thermal, and they obviously shouldn't have them because they're made in America and they shouldn't be in Mexico. And so that is the premise of their subpoena. This has never been done before. This news was broken today by Forbes.com. And so, you know, this isn't coming from the right or left. It's coming from Forbes.
Yeah.
Which means that Google or Apple leaked it to them, most likely, because this is an unprecedented subpoena, because it's not a subpoena to go after one bad guy. It's a subpoena to go after possible bad guys that might have these things.
And that's where it gets dangerous, is it's real easy to just... How can we do this without looking like we're trying to steal information? Well, we claim it's for something else. Because most people, just what you said, oh, they're trying to do it to make sure a cartel member in Mexico doesn't have this technology. How many people would, without really thinking, be like, oh, no, I agree. Yeah, we don't want them to have it. They're bad, bad people. We don't want them to have that type of technology.
And that could be the exact story. You could have you could have Green Berets working in Mexico right now hunting a sniper, and they want this information to find out where the fuck he is because they know he's using an ATM.
but it being the government, and with the current state of things, it could also very well mean they're using that as an excuse to find out who has this and try to use other avenues to find out who has what technology, who has what weaponry, who has, because one would assume if you have that, you probably also have firearms.
Sure.
And between this and all the other talk of them using social media platforms.
Oh, yeah, it gets worse.
Yeah, that's just where.
Yesterday, I was reading articles. And at first, the people I was with, I was doing a radio show with a local AM station. Yeah, they're still around. And the show was called Not Politically Correct. And we were talking about this. And this, they thought I was kidding. There are actually articles out there where the White House is entertaining proposals to enact social credit scoring like they use in China.
Yeah.
Okay, matter of fact, the guy that's pushing this is last name's Ling. Okay. So Chinese communism's coming to America, and they're wanting to impose social credit scoring as a gun control measure. So the way social credit scoring works, this is really scary, guys. The government would partner with Apple and Google and, you know, Amazon for Alexa. And the things you say in your home, say in front of your phone, say in front of your iWatch, the things you say on social media, they'd get with Facebook and Instagram and Google. And all these things would factor into a credit score, much like the one that you use to buy a house or a car or get a credit card. And your credit score would go down based on whether or not you're this sounds a lot like Facebook's community guidelines. Like, if you don't live up to their community guidelines, you're going to have a lower score. The lower your score, the less likely you're going to be able to buy a gun.
Yep.
A Republican congressman also put out an idea this week, similar, where he wants to do a gun credit score, and you would have a gun credit score. And so if you buy too much ammo too fast,
which, again, we're talking about the government who claims that 200 or 300 rounds is a stockpile of ammunition.
It's an arsenal.
We've shot that at.
I go through that in like 30 minutes.
How much ammo do you bring for Monster Match, TJ?
700 rounds.
Yeah. So is 200 or 300 rounds a stockpile when we bring 500 or 700 yeah. rounds to one match.
The AK match, last one that we did, it was 50. No, yeah, Kalashnikov, we went through 1,500 rounds of 7.62 and 5.45 in 2 days.
You go to a Haley strategic class, I think the round counts 1,200 or 1,500 rounds for a class.
Yeah, when you're paying that kind of money, you want to go pew, pew, pew a lot. Agreed. But anyway, so this a Republican had this idea that if you buy too many guns too fast, your credit score drops to where you can't buy any more.
Wait, you mean a liberal Democrat?
No,
right?
A Republican.
Yeah.
A conservative Republican, so-called conservative Republican. And that's why, you know, the threat, gentlemen, to our Second Amendment rights and our freedoms. This isn't just about the Second Amendment.
Yep.
It's about the First Amendment, the Second Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment, and the fucking Sixth Amendment. The threat is not from the left. The threat is from within. The threat is from the right. The threat is from guys like Crenshaw and this Republican with the fucking gun credit score idea and Melania Trump calling everybody saying, please do the red flag thing. The threat is from the right. NASCAR saying you can't fucking put an AR-15 on a car. I actually had the opportunity to put a Tactical Shit logo on a NASCAR for the Kansas City race coming up.
Yeah.
And I can't do it because my fucking logo has guns in it. NASCAR. I mean,
it's getting out of hand.
And NASCAR cites the gradual shift away from guns. I know a lot of NASCAR fans, and I have not seen any gradual shift in that community away from guns. The only gradual shift is the fucktards at the top of these huge corporations like Walmart that issue statements like, we're only banning 223 and 556 because it's short-barreled rifle ammunition that can commonly be used in high-capacity clips. They said clips. Their fucking press release says clips.
It is Walmart.
Right. Right. Because it's some fucking little girl that works at Walmart Corporate that typed up this press release.
Yeah, of course.
Anyway, shit's getting out of hand, folks. We are 48 minutes into what was supposed to be a 30-minute podcast, and we're not done yet.
There's a lot of shit right now. This is crazy because we'll admit it, even we got this way. Everybody got lackadaisical and no big deal and complacent because we had Daddy Savior Trump.
It's the Trump utopia. Nobody's going to come for our guns.
And we are now dealing with more shit than when Obama was president.
Nobody's going to give us a credit score, social credit score.
There's no reason to fight when Obama was president. This was forefront of the fight because it was Obama as president and the Democrats in charge. Now that this Republican's leading the charge and agreeing with this, there's no fight.
The next thing coming, the Texas shooter?
Yeah.
The guy that did the rampage on the highway between Odessa and Midland?
Yeah. Okay. Not the first one, but the most recent one.
Yeah, the first one. The most recent one. If you go back to episode 31, we're talking about that guy. This was last weekend. They just came out yesterday. They served a search warrant in Lubbock, Texas. I think there's a song about that. And they are now investigating the guy that sold him the AR-style rifle for manufacturing said rifle and selling it. Manufacturing and selling it. So there's a really good chance that that's an 80% lower is the origin of that rifle. And at least we've got some insider information that it was possibly an 80% lower. And so, you know, we couldn't give away 80s during the first 2 years of the Trump administration.
We stopped ordering them all together.
Yeah, we cleared out everything we had. I think we had like a couple 9s and 308s left, and we stopped selling them. Recently, after the Ohio shooting, our sales of 80s have gone through the roof.
As of yesterday, we were at 1,660 since August 6th.
Yeah, that's a lot of 80s being moved. And, you know, it's because of what's going on. All this talk of gun control and gun restriction. And so these, you know, guys are rightfully so running out and buying these 80s. And we had to put a limit of 3 per customer. And every single order is for 3 because these guys are buying them for their grandkids.
Yeah.
Right? And now, all of a sudden, we might have a way for them to come after that next. Just like the bump stocks, just like everything else. But there's a lot of legal that has to happen before then. And that's not all. The last thing I wanted to talk about today. You and I haven't even talked about this. The AA-12.
Oh, that made me sad, too, because I know when that first initial release of get your name on there for
the semi-auto
closed bolt. You were all about blown up trying to figure out how to get your name on.
Oh yeah. Yeah. They, so an article came out earlier this week And I'm going to quote the Gun Mag Warehouse. The BATF is reportedly seizing AA-12 shotguns. The cause of the AA-12 ATF confiscation, markings, and or transfer alleged by the agency to be inconsistent with federal law. They're basically saying that any semi-automatic AA-12s that were made because the original chassis, the original lower, if you will, it's really not a lower, but it's the original,
yeah.
I forget the word.
Firearm.
Yeah, the original firearm is full auto. And even though this thing requires 8 different parts and drilling different holes,
yep,
to become a machine gun, they're saying because it, you know, because the chassis was once a machine gun, it's always a machine gun. And they're going after these, supposedly about 22 of these things are out in the wild, and they're semi-autos. And it's largely gone under the radar. I mean, I haven't heard anybody talking about it other than some meme pages.
Yeah.
You know, that the ATF has sent letters to all the people that own these things saying that they need to fork them over or face machine gun charges. Sol Invictus Arms is the one that everybody's talking about, because Sol Invictus Arms, they're the ones that are currently designing and developing the AA-12 semi-automatic shotgun. You saw the here's a video of us real quick shooting the full auto AA-12 at SHOT Show with them.
I was trying to cut that leg in half.
So much fun. So much fun.
Yeah, that was probably a highlight of my day at range day for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, no, agreed.
So the letter says from the ATF, this letter officially notifies you that the AA-12 type shotgun in your possession is a machine gun. Period. You know, there's a whole lot more words, but that's the part that gets your attention.
Yeah.
And then, but the most interesting part about this, okay, now this is our tactical TMZ segment, right? Tactical TMZ, we always do this at the end of the podcast, seems to be a new trend. Sol Invictus Arms was very silent on this for a long time in the last week. And they just released a press release on Ammo Land, which is basically...
Very well done press release,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it's too long to read to you, but basically they say, to date, Sol Invictus Arms has not produced a single AA-12 for civilian sale, full auto or semi-auto. They haven't sold a single gun to anybody. And... if you read through this story, and I'll make sure this story is posted on Tactical Shit. If you read through TacticalShit.com, when you read through this story, it's basically Sol Invictus wanted to buy the technology, the patents, the designs, and everything from the guy that originally invented the full auto AA-12. He wouldn't sell to him. And so then there's another party or two parties involved where this other company had an FFL, and another guy had bought the rights to the designs, and he was building these things he believed to be under that FFL. Mm-hmm. And he was, and they were being logged on their forms, okay? But he wasn't listed on the FFL, so he was manufacturing machine guns under their FFL, but he wasn't listed on their FFL. Okay. And so then they evidently released 20-something of these things into the wild, including one to Sol Invictus Arms that they were using. It was a full auto version that they were using as the model to probably the one we shot.
Yeah.
That gun has been seized by the ATF, and they have not given it back. So they're basically collecting all of these things. And so what Sol Invictus is basically saying is that somebody else, not them, manufactured approximately 22 AA-12s using full-auto receivers, but only firing in semi-auto configuration. They were sold by this third party called BC Engineering, and they sold for between $5,000 and $7,500. And so basically, Sol Invictus is coming out and saying, hey, we were trying to build an AA-12 that was semi-auto from a semi-auto receiver. These guys that were involved early on, they built semi-auto versions, about 22 of them, using the full auto receivers to do so. Those are the guns, including the one we shot at SHOT Show. Those are the guns that the ATF are after. It's not Sol Invictus.
Yeah.
And so that's pretty incredible. The ATF says that Sol Invictus is not being investigated. They're not part of this issue. But some of these other guys are in pretty deep shit.
Well, from what I read, too, it looks like one of them is one of the guys who claims he's the original creator, made the call himself because he was butthurt.
I forgot about that part.
Yeah,
the original
basically a fucking snitch. That's why all this happened.
Yeah, karma's a bitch, dude. So, you're right. I forgot about that part because it's a long story.
No.
So the guy that originally held the patent got pissed because the people he licensed the patent to over here sold to Sol Invictus because he was trying to charge Sol Invictus a lot more money.
Yeah, they said Invictus some unreasonable amount.
Sol Invictus went around him, bought the technology from somebody else he licensed it to or sold it to, and then he got pissed, and he called the ATF, and the ATF looked at him, and they found out he was doing hood rat shit. He's the one in trouble.
That fucking backfired on his dumb ass.
That's precisely why I don't have an FFL.
No shit.
It's just too much to worry about. I'll build uppers and sell parts. That's about it.
Yep.
Anyway, guys, that wraps up Shots Fired episode 32.
Sure, give it a few more days. We'll be doing 33.
Yep. It's Friday night. It's time to go pop a cold one and go play with this Adams Arms 308 pistol before we actually have to send it to one of these lucky shitheads that are registering to win it right now.
Gonna rub my balls on it.
I already did.
Son of a bitch.
See you, shitheads. Keep your head on a swivel and train your mind, your body, and your hands for war, hoping that you never have to use it.
Agreed.
See ya.